Well, Alan is a hard act to follow, but nonetheless, I must. A very good morning and a welcome here to St. Paul's Bloor Street. My name's Jenny Anderson. I have the privilege of serving as the rector here. And despite the delays on the TTC, we're so glad that you've been able to join us this morning. And a very warm welcome to the hundreds who join us each and every Sunday online. We're so glad that you're here. And because you can never have too much Easter, happy Easter. Happy Easter. We're so glad you've joined us for our service of Easter lessons and carols. We'll be listening to the wonderful story of how God has interacted with humanity in the Old Testament and the New Testament today in the scripture readings, and then led in song and praise by our wonderful choir here in our 11 o'clock service. St. Paul's is a diverse community. We're a growing community, learning how to follow Jesus Christ in the heart of the city. And if it is your first time here, particularly warm welcome, and we'll hope to connect with you after the service. But there really are new people every single week. So we'd love for you to stand, try and spot someone you don't know. Head on over, wish them happy Easter, give them a warm welcome. Friends, please stand, welcome each other. And as you're standing, let's join our voices together and sing our opening hymn, Christ the Lord is Risen Today.
Thank you. Well, good morning and welcome again to St. Paul's Bloor Street. Please do go ahead and take your seats. We're so glad that you're here, and I want to extend a special welcome to anyone who visited for the first time over Holy Week, maybe Easter Day, and decided to come back. We're just delighted that you've come back to join us in worship. If it's your first time or you're visiting and you haven't been here long, please know everything you need for the service will be on the screen. There's no wrong way to be here. Just join in as you feel comfortable. I do want to say this is an Easter, reiterate what Bishop Jenny said, this is an Easter lessons and carol service. All of our worship is participatory and interactive. It's a thing that we offer up to God, but maybe especially a lessons and carol service because it calls us to active ears and also to active voices. So just invite you into that. Now, happy to welcome Francesca and Wolfie up to light the Christ candle as we celebrate the light of Christ being given to us this Easter season. Alleluia. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Praise the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He has given us new life and hope. He has raised Jesus from the dead. God has claimed us as his own. He has brought us out of darkness. He has made us light to the world. Alleluia. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. As we take a posture of prayer, I invite us into the collect for Easter and then the collect for today, the first Sunday after Easter. Together we pray. Lord of all life and power, who through the mighty resurrection of your Son overcame the old order of sin and death to make all things new in him, grant that we, being dead to sin and alive to you in Jesus Christ, may reign with him in glory, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be praise and honor, glory and might, now and in all eternity. Amen. Almighty Father, who has given your only Son to die for our sins and to rise again for our justification, grant us so to put away the leaven of malice and wickedness, that we may always serve you in pureness of living and truth, through the merits of the same, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The first lesson is taken from the book of Isaiah, chapter 25, beginning at the 6th verse. Isaiah wrote, "On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-matured wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-matured wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations, and he will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, 'Lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation.' This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God."
Death's blood hath lost his cheer, since Jesus' cross The second lesson is taken from the book of Zephaniah, chapter 3, beginning at the 14th verse. The word of the Lord came to Zephaniah, "Sing aloud, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O Israel. Rejoice and exult with all your heart, O daughter Jerusalem. The Lord has taken away the judgments against you. He has turned away your enemies. The King of Israel, the Lord, is in your midst. You shall fear disaster no more. On that day, it shall be said to Jerusalem, 'Do not fear, O Zion. Do not let your hands grow weak. The Lord, your God, is in your midst, a warrior who gives victory. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will renew you in his love. He will exult over you with loud singing, as on a day of festival. I will remove disaster from you, so that you will not bear reproach for it. I will deal with all your oppressors at that time, and I will save the lame and gather the outcast, and I will change their shame into praise and renown in all the earth. At that time, I will bring you home. At that time, when I gather you, for I will make you renowned and praised among all the peoples of the earth when I restore your fortunes before your eyes, says the Lord." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The third lesson is taken from the book of Romans, chapter 6, beginning at the third verse. Paul wrote, "Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The fourth lesson is taken from the book of 1 Peter, chapter 1, beginning at the third verse. Peter wrote, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you who are being protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, even if you're for a little while you've had to suffer various trials, so that geniuses of your faith, being more precious than gold that, though perishable, is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him. Even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy, for you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your soul. This is the word of the God.
The fifth lesson is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, beginning at the first verse. After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descending from heaven came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him. This is my message for you." So they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came to him, took hold of his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." This is the word of the Lord.
The sixth lesson is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, beginning at the 16th verse. Now, the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always, to the end of the age." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. where you're standing, let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be pleasing and acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. Happy Easter and welcome back to St. Paul's Bloor Street. A particular warm welcome if you are joining with us from last week and you came to visit and you come back with us. We're glad to see you again. Well, 22 and a half years ago, early on a Tuesday morning, as women and men were going to work, a peculiar thing happened. Airplanes flew into buildings. And many of us could tell and retell the story of where we were when that happened. Perhaps you can remember what you were doing when you heard the news. And if you've been traveling before 9/11, you remember how much changed. There's now TSA with long security lines at the airport, armed police with machine guns patrolling, and if you didn't hear the slogan then, you'll hear it now, even on the TTC. If you see something, say something. There was a pre-9/11 world, and then with the events of that day, an instant round-the-clock CNN coverage in the aftermath of 3,000 victims, September 12th, 2001, was the start of a new era. Today, we are in a different aftermath. A different aftermath after another murder. But this aftermath goes back 2,000 years to that first Easter day, where each and every day since is a post-resurrection day, a post-Easter reality. In his 33 years on earth, with 3 years of ministry before Jesus was killed, that was all pre-Easter, pre-resurrection. And then so much changed on that weekend. From the Friday when Jesus was killed to the Sunday when his tomb is discovered empty, Jesus rising from the dead was an event that had worldwide consequences, affecting all peoples of the earth. Sin, death, and the devil were all dealt a fatal blow. So this morning we have Easter 2.0, a second Sunday to tell and retell the Easter story, to dwell deeply into this amazing story, to reflect on this earth-shattering event. In our scriptures this morning, all six of them, we have these various encounters, but especially as we look at the first one in Isaiah, we have this encounter over a feast between God and all peoples. Then in Matthew's gospel, it's a sudden encounter on Easter morning between women at the tomb and meeting Jesus, and that was truly an unexpected encounter. These encounters between the human and the divine. And these encounters, they precipitated action, something to do. Action, reaction. There's a mission that flows out of this encounter between God and humankind. A cause and effect, a sudden encounter, and then a mission. In this service of lessons and carols, we have been spending time listening to Scripture and then responding through song, inhaling Scripture and exhaling songs of praise, breathing in God's word and breathing out words of praise. In a way, we are following in the footsteps of Mary Magdalene and the other Mary. We have cause and effect. We see something and then we say something. An encounter leads to a mission. As you are listening to these scripture this morning, did you hear echoes of the Old Testament in the Easter story? Centuries before Jesus, the prophet Isaiah foretells of a day of celebration, a feast, a day of salvation, a feast of rich foods, a feast of well-matured wines. This is a meal full of umami. It's not a microwave dinner. And on that day, Isaiah tells of God swallowing up death forever, wiping away the tears from every face. And it's this Easter 2.0 that we are telling and retelling that same story of God's salvation for the world. Because at its best, the church, at its very best, we're telling that story every week. This is a salvation, a saving act of God that is foretold in the Old Testament through prophets like Isaiah that we heard, Zephaniah, to the whole nation of freed slaves, but also a people that were struggling to love and follow God. But as much as it was a message for an entire nation, it was also a personal, an intimate encounter, an intimate story that it was experienced by Mary Magdalene and this other Mary. It's a story that inspired disciples like Peter, like Paul, to write letters encouraging the early church and the first believers. And it's a story that, if we allow it, it weaves its way into our own lives too. The Easter story isn't a fable reserved for infants and babies. It's not like this children's picture book. It's not like children's picture books that are meant to understand the basic wisdom of the world. It's not like Aesop's Fables or the Brothers Grimm. In many cultures around the world, there are resurrection myths that they parallel the Christian Easter story. There are these myths of special individuals who have conquered death, maybe a legend of a special potion that brings people back to life, a secret mystical place where people might live forever. Maybe you're thinking of Shangri-La, El Dorado. But the Easter story is no myth, no legend. While there are different accounts of Jesus' resurrections in each of the four Gospels, they all agree on the same peculiar thing. A Jewish man named Jesus was tortured and killed, and 3 days later, his tomb was found empty. And many people saw him alive. As Christians, we believe that this is no myth, no legend. It's why we have the names of those first women who found that empty tomb. All four of those Gospels, they record Mary Magdalene as the first person. And then there's all these other women that were with her as well. In all the different Gospels, the first people to discover the empty tomb, they're women, and we know them by name. It's like a footnote for the first century reader. If you don't believe me, well, you can ask them. We know them. We know where they live. Before we walk a mile in their shoes, it's worth considering what state of mind the women were on that fateful morning as they were walking to the tomb. From our Old Testament readings, the Jewish nation was clinging to this hope of a better day. They faced enemy nations all around them, from Egypt to Babylon to the Roman Empire that had just murdered Jesus. They were oppressed and beaten down, but they clung to the hope of God's promise, this promise of salvation and deliverance that the prophets like Isaiah and Zephaniah had told them and reminded them over and over again. And so they waited for that day when God would deliver them. As the prophet Isaiah wrote, and as we heard read, it will be said on that day, "Lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us." On that day. But on that day, that Easter morning, Mary Magdalene and the other women, they weren't thinking of that promise. Their hearts and minds were furthest from thoughts of salvation and deliverance. They were in the first stages of grief. Some of you will know, and perhaps you've attended, the program that we have here at St. Paul's called Grief Share. It's for individuals who have lost family members and close friends, those that have died recently. It's a program meant to give Christian hope based on biblical scripture, but it's a 10, 12-week program. Mary, she was on day 3. 3 days since seeing her friend brutally tortured and murdered. And so her heart, their hearts, their minds are far from this promise of salvation and deliverance. A breakthrough in cancer treatment doesn't mean much if your friend has already died. You don't want to touch that feast of rich food and well-matured wines if there are empty seats around your table. So the women, they went to the tomb to do their obligation, to perform their duty, to respect Jesus' dead body. A simple task, but solemn and important, though. But suddenly there's a great earthquake. Suddenly, because earthquakes are never expected, there's no 5-minute countdown. Hey, an earthquake is happening. Suddenly, the stone was rolled back. Suddenly, there was an angel sitting there. Suddenly, because the woman could not have imagined what was going to happen, what had happened, suddenly because the dead body of their Lord and teacher was no longer in that tomb. Whenever we encounter a sudden event, whether it's a good one or a bad event, all our studies in psychology, they tell us that we are hardwired to respond in three ways. Fight, flight, or freeze. Many of you will know this from Psychology 101. Maybe it's a surprise birthday. You're kind of frozen there as everyone yells surprise. Or it's a surprise pregnancy. Or maybe it's even just on the road. The car in front of you breaks suddenly or swerves. Fight, flight, or freeze. Suddenly, there's this great earthquake, and the guards around the tomb, they shook with fear, and they froze. And we don't know if the women were getting ready to fight, or maybe they're getting ready to run away in flight, but the angel tells them, "Do not be afraid." The women have this sudden encounter with this angel, the divine, a heavenly messenger from God. And like so many other encounters between heavenly beings and human beings, the first words are almost always the same. Do not be afraid. And then the angel continues, "Jesus is not here. Jesus has been raised." And immediately after this encounter, the women are given a task, a mission. Go quickly. Go quickly and tell the other disciples. They saw the empty tomb, and the angel reminded them like a TSA announcement on repeat. If you see something, say something. The women saw something, and now they were going to say something. They were on their way. They left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy. They had a message to tell. This angel had told them, go on, tell the others. And they probably didn't fully comprehend what was going on that day and what had just happened over the past 3 days with this empty tomb. Actually, no one understood. Even Jesus' closest disciples didn't understand until Jesus had to spell it out for them. And as they're going, another suddenly. Suddenly, Jesus met them and said, greetings. Suddenly, because the dead body of their Lord and teacher was no longer in the tomb, it's actually standing right in front of them. Suddenly, because this dead body is speaking to them. It intrigues me, these two sudden encounters. I've seen enough crisis situations to know that one sudden encounter puts you off kilter. You're already in that flight, fight, or freeze mode. But now Jesus appears to them suddenly. Why do these two sudden encounters matter to those first women? Why does it matter to us today? That first sudden event, that earthquake, was something that many people would have experienced. All around Jerusalem, they would have felt something happening. Or maybe it's like the solar eclipse tomorrow. A lot of people are going to see it, but there are some places where, you know, life just goes on. It's a widespread experience, maybe generalizable, but it's also something that you might be able to dismiss. Just wait for the next one. You know, there's another eclipse in a few more years. Not a big deal. But the second sudden encounter is deeply personal and intimate. It's why they came to him. It's why they hold on to his feet. It's why they worshiped him. On Maundy Thursday, I preached about the intimacy of Jesus washing the feet of his disciples. And actually, Mary Magdalene, that same Mary, that first Mary, had also washed Jesus' feet. She had doused them with perfume and dried his feet with her hair. And now she was holding his feet again. She recognized them. The woman took hold of his feet because this is a sudden encounter, an experience that is personal, intimate. And they didn't just receive a telephone tag message of Jesus is risen. They saw him with their own eyes. They held him. They held his feet with their own hands. A sudden earthquake, a heavy stone rolled away, an angel. These are all amazing, I'm sure. And even today, it's amazing when we hear news from the other side of the world, whether that's CNN, Facebook, or social media. But we wait to tell big news, good news, big or small, We look to tell that good news, bad news in person, face to face, expecting a grandchild, a medical diagnosis, the death of a childhood friend. But when it comes to the best news, the biggest news of all, that Jesus is raised and alive, this is best told personally. It's like having that breakthrough in cancer treatment, but it now means everything if you're the one in the trial group. Or a feast of rich foods with well-matured wines, that's worth savoring if you're with all the people that you love. On that first Easter Sunday morning, the women experienced these two sudden encounters, and they were likely gripped with joy and fear at the same time. But Jesus met them in the middle of their mixed emotions. And those first words are the same for them as it is for us. Do not be afraid. Jesus meets us on our way wherever we are going. Maybe it's in the mundane tasks of caring for our sick loved ones. Maybe it's in our tears of pain and loss as we're trying to remember and hold on to the memory of Isaiah's prophecy that God will wipe away every tear from our face. Jesus meets us also in joyful news of recovery and new life. Jesus meets us in all our mixed emotions in this post-Easter reality. So if you think back over the past few days, maybe you've encountered something. Maybe it's a shock. Maybe it's a sudden encounter that you did not expect. An emotion that you didn't see coming. A feeling. Maybe it's a question. Perhaps you have seen something, you've heard something peculiar these past days. You've heard this news about Jesus risen, but you haven't yet encountered Jesus personally yet. You don't know what it means for this dead man to be alive, but you've seen something. I suggest to you, go and tell others what you have heard, what you have already seen, even if you don't 100% know what it's all about. Tell someone what you've heard and what you've seen, and then ask them what it means. We have a Turning to Christ course that is starting next week where you can ask those questions and you can ask what it means that this risen man is alive, that Christ is alive. And if you have encountered Jesus personally, maybe it was this week, maybe it's this morning in the songs and in the scriptures, maybe it was over the weekend. Maybe it was your first time, your 20th time, your 100th time. There is a task ahead for you, a mission for you to do. Go and tell others, your coworkers, your friends, your family, you have witnessed something. You saw something. So go and say something as well. If you see something, say something. Jesus Christ is risen and alive today. Do not be afraid. Go and tell someone. Amen.
Friends, we respond to hearing the proclamation of the Word of God by joining in the words of the Apostles' Creed, which unites us with Christians who are worshiping around the world today and indeed throughout time. We also recognize that people are at different places on their spiritual journey, so we're not asking you to say anything you don't believe, but as you're able, let's join together in the words of the Creed. Do you believe and trust in God the Father?
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe and trust in his Son, Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe and trust in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
Blessed are you, Lord God of Israel, forever and ever. All that is in heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you, and from your own hand we have given you. Amen. Together let us pray. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, humbly and heartily thank you for all your goodness and loving kindness. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, by which we claim forgiveness and hope for eternal life. And we thank you for the gift of grace and the hope of glory. Give us, we pray, a sense of all your mercies so that we would be sincerely thankful and full of praise in all that we say and do, by giving ourselves to your service in a holy and righteous manner every day, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, forever and ever. Amen. Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time to bring before you our common supplications, and you have promised that when two or three are gathered together in your name, you will grant their requests. So, Lord, fulfill now the desires and prayers of your people in ways and to degrees that are best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the world to come, life everlasting. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Together. Almighty God, give us grace to cast away the works of darkness and to put on the armor of light, now in this time of this mortal life, in which your Son, Jesus Christ, came to us in great humility, that on the last day, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge the living and the dead, we may rise to the life immortal. Through him who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Christ, the Son of Righteousness, shine upon you. Scatter the darkness from before your path and make you ready to meet him when he comes again in glory. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the risen Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you in this Easter season and remain with you forevermore. Amen. Friends, please be seated. We're just so glad so many of you have joined us here today, and Susie's going to wrap us up with some closing announcements.
Well, a very good morning from me. It's great to see you. My name is Susie. I'm a part of the team here. And to those of you who are joining us in person and those online, we're so thankful that you've been with us this morning for our Easter lessons and carols as we've celebrated once again the great and glorious resurrection of Jesus Christ. We're a diverse and growing community learning to follow the way of Jesus in downtown Toronto. And we recognize that many of us are at different stages in our spiritual journey. Some of you are committed, some of you are curious, some of you may even be critical. Wherever you're at, we have a place for you here. And particularly if you're new, we would love to get to know you. One of the best ways that we can do that is to invite you to fill out one of our connection cards. You can do so by following the QR code in front of you. Tell us a little bit more about yourself, and we can find ways to connect you to our community. And for those of you who have been new but have been attending for some time and have decided to consider St. Paul's your home, we would love to invite you to be a part of our new member Sunday. That's happening next Sunday, April the 14th. It's an opportunity to welcome and acknowledge those people who are choosing to call St. Paul's their spiritual home. If you are interested in being a part of that service, do have a conversation with Bishop Jenny after the service. Next week, we're beginning a new sermon series, and we're calling it How to Pray When Life is Hard. We recognize that many of us experience struggles throughout life, and sometimes there can feel a pressure to put on our Sunday best and pretend that everything is completely fine. But we find in the scriptures a model for praying, particularly when we're at our worst. So we're going to journey through the book of the Psalms, looking at some prayers and songs and how they can be for us a guardrail to pray when we're finding life particularly difficult. So we'd love to see you from next Sunday. Do join us. And I'd love to invite Tiffany now to come up and share with us some more announcements. Do welcome Tiffany, our families minister.
Thank you, Susie. Here at St. Paul's, we want to support strong and loving and resilient families. We want to support parents in guiding and leading their families. And towards that end, as the families minister, I am going to be leading a Building Healthy Families workshop in about a week and a half on a Wednesday night, and it'll run concurrent with youth ministry. And we're going to be looking, it's for parents of preteens and teens. We'll be looking at some of the bumps in the road that you experience when your kids are at that stage of life, and working on some practical tools around communication and conflict and navigating their ever-increasing independence. So please do look to the website, the events tab for registration and more information about that workshop. And now I would like to invite the participants in the Turning to Christ course to come forward. As they're coming forward, let me just tell you a little bit about the course. It starts next Sunday, and it is a course that people are taking to deepen their understanding of the saving love of Jesus Christ. Many take it as a preparation for baptism, for themselves or for their child. Come on up here with me. Or as a way to re-engage with their faith and go through a process of exploration for a reaffirmation of faith.
Thank you.
Come on up. Let's go back this way a little bit. Thanks, you guys. Wonderful. Good job. So right now, as a community, we are going to take some time to pray for them, to support them in this deeply important commitment that they've made in their life to explore their life with God more fully. So let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for Francesca, who is preparing for the baptism of Wolfie, and for Tala and Lucas, who are preparing for the baptism of Ruby and Carmen. Thank you for Sharon and for Dominic, who are preparing for the baptism of Samara. We thank you, too, for Bianca, who is preparing for her baptism, for Carl, Kathleen, and Paul, who are preparing for their baptism. We thank you, Lord, and lift up Lisanna and Charlotte, who are preparing for a reaffirmation of faith. We ask you, Lord, to bless them with a sense of being met by you in the concerns of their hearts and minds as they participate in turning to Christ. May this be a season of joy in learning and of peace in discerning the next steps in their life of faith with you, Lord. We ask all these things in your name. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Francesca. And as they make their way back to their seats, I invite you after the service to join us for cookies and coffee in the atrium. There is confidential prayer in St. Paul's Chapel, just on the other side of the glass atrium. And now I invite you to stand and to join us for our closing hymn, O Praise Ye the Lord.
He is not here, he is risen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.